Well, as a new football coach here, this is an exciting day for me. You know, there's a standard that we want to set for Southern Oregon football. We've got to live up to as coaches and players, and we want to set the standard today.
That was Craig Howard during his first week of spring practice as head coach of the Raiders. Howard took over a team that went 3-7 the year before and had just one winning season since 2003.
My last hit the sound of a screech of a man about to crash. Wishing for some help, but his pride never asked. All alone, because every girl he loved would never last.
Raiders made the playoffs that year, advancing to the quarterfinals before losing in overtime to Morningside.
Yeah, but these tears keep on falling the same. But I can't relate to all them. I think I've changed forever, a slave to cheddar. Let it blaze, get paid, enjoy the weather. I need a break, just saying this gold don't glitter.
Despite the letdown in 2013, the Raiders came into this year returning all but one offensive starter and many key players on defense.
The ramp is a ramp. These memories are all I ever had. I know that I ain't perfect. People say I don't deserve it, but my heart to fight, I ain't stopping with the curtain. They say,
you know, Austin Dodge is going to go deep at some point.
Tell me if it's worth it. Angels chilling, shirtless. Fans give me praise as I'm rising to the
22nd ranked Southern Oregon hosting second-ranked Carroll College to a statement win, 38-35, the final. Ninth-ranked Southern Oregon hosting College of Idaho, 476 yards and 5 touchdowns for Dodge. The Raiders win 56-28.
My only option is to make it. This is low-sitting higher than your expectations, yeah.
Defeated Raider team had the atmosphere buzzing in Ashland. The Raider defense dominates in this one. SOU is 6-0 after a 31-6 win on the new turf.
My only option is to make it. This is low sitting higher than your expectations. Yeah.
The Saints would go to their senior tailback, Dustin Rinker, and he would deliver. He finished with 201 yards rushing on the day.
Now Southern at 7-1 overall, 6-1 in conference play. Kirk looks and throws it away, intercepted. Dodge, third down and long, airs it out, and it's caught! First down! Get their first ever win over Rocky Mountain. I think it was the most complete game I've seen this season by Southern Oregon.
So the season moved along pretty well. We got better each week. You know, we're talking about playing home playoff games, and you know, we hadn't done that. There was one game left in the season. It was our in-state rivals, the East Oregon University Mounties.
Last year, in Southern Oregon's last home game of the season, the Raiders fumbled with 38 seconds left in the game, and Eastern Oregon ousted SOU from a potential spot in the NAIA playoffs. 38-37 was the final in that game.
So an SOU win today assures the Raiders of at least a share of their second Frontier Conference title in 3 years and a first-round home playoff game.
You know, it was a matchup situation that created a problem for us. We knew that when we played them once already. They were good at the corner position, which took a little bit about what we did away from offense.
We are just about set to go. I'm a little nervous about this one. Eastern Oregon has kind of had the Raiders' number, and this is a big ball game for them. They're coming in here with a purpose. They want to steal one today and put themselves right in the national playoff picture.
I feel like we were definitely confident going into that week, for sure. I feel like we was definitely feeling wildly confident in our play and in ourselves and how we know we could perform.
Raiders in their red home uniforms today, moving right to left as you watch the game with us. Dodge looks, fires, straight pass, caught inside the 40. He'll break the tackle and is tripped up as he gets inside the 30-yard line.
We started off pretty well. I mean, I felt that we performed pretty well. We went down and scored on our first possession, and we took a couple deep ball shots, and we were playing well and we were playing fast.
Fuller Field at Raiders Stadium. Dodge takes it inside and scores the touchdown. Pretty simple. Play fake to Tau and Dodge takes it in.
That's our mini Civil War. And of course they want to beat us. And they were trying to get into the playoffs. We already knew we were going.
6-0 Raiders with 8 minutes to go and counting here in the first quarter, and they want more. First down, 10 at the Mountaineer 27-yard line. Play action fake, and Dodge looks, throws, and it'll be caught! Touchdown, Raiders!
I don't think it was a situation where anybody took Eastern Oregon lightly. I think part of the deal is Eastern Oregon was good.
Tomorrow afternoon, Dodge drops back, looks over the middle, intercepted! He was gone for Matt Retzloff, and what the linebackers just...
It was just so weird because it almost, like, parts of it didn't seem real, and it was a roller coaster.
On the screen, Billingsley, first down yardage, down the right sideline, Calcano has to chase...
I feel like that's the first time that I felt like we were on our heels a little bit.
The pace of the game slowed down, and I feel like that's kind of what drove us into like a sluggish momentum, a sluggish mood. And
boy, at times Eastern just makes it look easy.
Yeah, they do, and again, electing to go with the screen pass around the left.
At their stage, their whole goal was just to beat us.
In the third, Eastern leads at 21-20. Barlow, play fake, takes it down the left sideline, first down as he tries.
In our mindsets, it was almost like we had all this motivation to beat them, but there was still a step in the process that we needed to do.
Billingsley in the backfield. Barlow looks, throws, wide open, caught, first down to midfield.
At that point in the season, we're a good football team. You know, we've done all these great things, and then that was kind of the day that we realized we weren't invincible.
Billingsley in the backfield, takes the handoff, makes a cut, gets considerable yardage across midfield into Raider territory, and another first down, a 17-yard pickup.
And the Mountaineers just picking up where they left off and continuing that bruising rushing attack.
And so all of a sudden, everything felt slow. Everything felt like it slowed down. We weren't going fast. They weren't going fast. Time was flying by. I truly don't know what happened. That was a case where the game finished, and I mean, throughout the whole game, you thought you had it in the bag. You thought we were playing well. And
the end zone, looks, throws, complete. Matt Retzloff, Ryan Retzloff, he'll pitch it over to Shane McShane, and he'll try to get out of bounds. He can't do it, and that will do it. And Eastern has upset Southern Oregon at Raider Stadium on the final day of the regular season.
Going from, like, hey, you know, we can host all the way until Daytona Beach, all this stuff, and then we lose to Eastern, and then we're like, holy, like, we're going to get in, right?
It's hard because you have so much success, and you feel so good about yourself. Where is that line where it's time to reevaluate some things?
So that's why, like, once we lost, then we realized that we can't just think we're going to beat people like that, because it's not going to work that way.
And a bunch of seniors were crying in the locker room and everything. Drew Gibson walks in. He goes, I don't know why you guys crying. Because it's a setback, yes. But we're still going to win the national title.
The football program, I wouldn't say, there's just a lack of interest, a lack of connection that the alums, the community, and the school had with our football program before Coach Howard and the staff showed up. There was a block of time there where there wasn't a whole lot of pride in the program.
Yeah, I'd say there was concern among the alums, in particular football alums, that we didn't know if we were going to have football. It had been over a decade since we had been in a conference or league. And so I think there was some talk out in the community that maybe football is not going to be around.
Jumping on staff and still having the struggle of not having a conference and continuing each and every week playing a different level, you know, from playing North Dakota 1 week, and then the next week you're playing Willamette. That's tough to do.
You know, 4 years ago when I applied for the job at Southern Oregon University, I got on the YouTube and the internet, typed in Southern Oregon football, you know, to try to, you know, find out as much about this program as I possibly could. So I typed in Southern Oregon football, and what pops up is the bus had caught on fire on a road trip.
Hey, grab our shit, dude.
Oh, no. that was the only thing on the internet that you could find out about Southern Oregon football.
You shouldn't have to go out and try to get support. The support should already be there, from alums to the community. It was almost like a task to get people to come to the games.
There was pride that they played football at SOU, but it sort of capped. Like, yeah, we're Raiders, and then it sort of stopped. And they didn't get that external feel and the community buying in.
I've been around it for a long time, and the NAIA for a long time, I remember the first time I came to Southern Oregon, I always thought you could win here. Walking down the ramp where you can kind of see Grizzly Peak and the field and all this, and it's kind of breathtaking, and I sat there and said, you can win here, you can win high.
Broke out a retention chart amongst all the programs. We looked at them all in football. Retention with the players was about 40%, 48%, something like that. Kids were coming and leaving.
National championships sound different because I also knew the scholarship limitations that we had at Southern Oregon. So I think probably the biggest hurdle that we overcame was our scholarship limitations. Again, being the only state school in the playoff, where scholarships are harder to come by than the private schools.
You know, we first went on the road recruiting the very first year we got here. Coach Howard said, go out and promise every high school kid that gets on board and jumps in the pool that we're going to win a national championship and you're going to get a degree.
It's always something that has been, it was never like a saying, it was always promised. You know, Coach Howard told you, when you leave here, you're going to have a great degree from a great university, and you're going to have a national championship ring on your finger.
We went out to every high school in Oregon, Northern California, Southern Washington, and we told those kids that, and every one of those coaches went, yeah, right.
Everybody's told that we're going to win a national championship, and it's one of those goals. It seems like a lofty goal, and it's a great one to have set on it. And I think everybody believes that they could win it.
You know, when you start talking about national championship, it was a different deal because I didn't know about talking about winning. Because my years as a coach and as a player, you know, in college it was mediocre.
I think when he came in, like, there was two parts of me. There was a part that said, holy crap, I'm buying into this. Maybe it's a possibility that it could be me. And then there was another part of it, this, like, realism said, and I said, you know, there was skepticism in there.
It's something that, you know, it took me at least a good year and a half to really truly believe, like, yeah, you know what, I'm going to set myself up to win a national championship. What can I do as a coach so we can win? What can I do as a coach to recruit the best? Yeah. You know what I mean? It kind of really changed my mindset.
You know, I talked to him about it on the phone, thought he was a crazy old man, and you don't know what Southern Oregon University is. And I had a bad attitude about it. I mean, it took me a while to overcome all the previous years here to really buy into what he was doing. But as soon as he stepped in front of our guys, I mean, I knew right away that he was for real.
We're going to win a national championship. We told him from the outset 4 years ago that was our quest and our desire.
First thing he says, you know, you guys are either with me or not with me. He said, this is the pool. And if you're with me, jump with 2 feet into the pool. We're going to go to the national championship. And so, I mean, that's what got me.
You know, in 2012, we went to the quarterfinals, and, you know, we lost by literally an inch. And then the next season, we had, like, 2013 is just so mediocre that we knew we were so much better than that with so many guys returning that we knew that it was really this year or bust almost.
And now that we've got a conference, now we've got some stability, now that we've got a head coach with the right frame of mind, that we're going to do some special things.
Tonight, under the lights here, the Raider offense will face a defense that ranks fourth in the NAIA in points allowed per game.
Get down! Get down! Get down! Get down! Get down!
first pulled up the tape, remember? We were watching it, Coach Aaron pulled it up, and we're like, dude. I'm like, oh, man. And I just remember, like, okay.
First down, 15. He probably feels that way. Here's the throw to the end zone. Caught! And it is a touchdown!
And then once we started becoming coaches and not being fans, we're like, all right, we're good.
Kind of almost, hey, second chance, here we go. We messed up, now we got this home game, let's do something with it.
I remember going to halftime, and you could just look at every kid going, we're going to play next week, and it was pretty cool.
15 minutes to go. Dodge and the Raiders with the football, looking down, throws it complete. Touchdown to Dylan Young. Retzloff there again. Matt hit behind the line. Still on his feet. Dives in. Touchdown!
We went through a period in 2013 we thought we had arrived, we thought things were going to be handed to us, and we lost the focus of working hard.
There was, the leadership wasn't there, the kind of motivation wasn't there. We had a really great season, and we thought we were going to just get another one handed to us. It was kind of a bad way to experience my junior year, and that season was also not what we wanted it to be, and all the games we lost were so close, we came up short so much, and I think something that we wanted to change the next year was making sure everybody's jumping in the pool. And that's something that Coach Howard brought to us, is saying, you're not going to have one foot in the pool, you're not going to have one foot out of the pool. If you're not jumping in the pool, you're not on the team at all.
And I think we started building leaders in the weight room, and I think that was something that we failed to do going into 13. We held, not only held our guys accountable, we held our leaders accountable to hold their teammates accountable.
Went back and revamped the off season. We got new leadership in the weight room, and one of the things that we wanted to do was build discipline and build a structure in the weight room that was conducive to what we were trying to accomplish on the field.
You know, the investment in the off season, you know, we always say, you know, you don't win national championships in the month of August. You know, it starts in the month of January when we get to the off season program. It's when we grind and we get after our kids, and you know, we put them in those adverse situations.
But with guys like Daniel Bro and Heston Altenbach and Drew Gibson and some of these senior leaders, Dustin Frutwell, if guys weren't working, coaches didn't have to do anything. They took care of it.
Just knowing that the person next to you, you know how hard he's worked, just like you, how much work you put in, so you know all the sweat that he's put in to get there, and it's just... Since you know that, it just makes things different, you know. It builds a bond, an unspoken bond that you can't even explain really like that.
And everybody stuck around with the team, and the team became a team, and everybody was in it to win it, literally.
The offseason is so important because I can grind with my brothers, because it's not about me putting my work in, it's about I make sure I put my work in for my brother.
They had their minds made up all offseason. You know, there was no doubt, there was no question marks, it was... The goal was set, there was a mission,
and their minds were made up. And, you know, I think one of the coolest ones was St. Valentine's Day Massacre.
Our very first year, the first massacre, and for some of you, it'll be your first massacre tonight, your rookies at it. It was changed each year. It really signifies a change in the, from the recruiting to the preparation. You know, I know we've been training up to this point, but now we're really done recruiting, and it's time to get this football team ready to beat Carroll College.
Going into that and looking back at it, in any tough situation this whole season, I picture myself back in the February 14th, and I've never gone through anything harder in my life. It was pouring down rain. It was cold out. It was muddy. No one had any idea what to expect.
We are here because your coaches wanted us to test your mental toughness. We don't know if you have it.
This is what's gonna make you different. Stuff like this becoming a team.
Got black chucks on my feet, painted boots, ready to roll deep. Keep me feeling that blue dream, and that cushion put you to sleep. But be blessed loud like the pants out, and they passed out from that last round. If you're doing things, they mad now, they sad now.
Whenever we were in a tough situation in the game, someone was beat up, we were hurt, bloody, sweaty out there, I just took myself back to the Valentine's Day Massacre and said to myself, I've been through worse. We compete, we get after, we have a winner and a loser, because that's ultimately what the game's all about. There's always going to be a winner and a loser.
At the 1 minute mark, I'm going to go get you.
Later, what weapon, how are you guys carrying it?
I would never forget Valentine's Massacre. I mean, and we saw it was going to be pouring rain in the forecast.
Oh, it was horrible. No one was looking forward to it.
They were like, oh boy.
Other groups not doing all the reps, you need to go call them out. Don't tell me you're the only one doing stuff.
To see these guys grow as seniors, and that's, they grew in the program over the course of 4 years, and they did. They took the leadership of the team.
Our mind was on a national championship, and I think that year we gave the national championship effort in everything we did.
Said right after the game, I had my family coming up to me and they were like, so what do you think? Where are we going next week? Are we going to be in Iowa? Are we going to be in Chicago? You know, and I just kept telling my mom, I was like, we're going to be in Carroll.
Yeah. Carroll College is one of the great programs in the NAIA. I think they've won 8 national titles in about 12 years. They turned into a pretty good rivalry right off the bat.
It'll be the final play of the game. Still on his feet, looks, airs it out down the field into the Raiders secondary, tipped, and the Raiders have upset 6th-rated Carroll College 52-49.
It kind of started and got people's attention in the fact that we'd beat them. It really goes back to 2001 and 2002 when Southern Oregon got into the playoffs and played Carroll College, and once at home and once up there in Helena. And both times Southern Oregon's leading the game in the fourth quarter, and Carroll College came back and won the game and eliminated Southern Oregon for the playoffs. That was the only time they ever played.
It's what you look for as a coach or athlete. Anytime it's the true worthy adversary, that we are 500 against them, it's been a dogfight every time we've ever played them. We score more points than they ever give up when we play them. They score more points than we usually give up when they play us. And it's going to be who wants it the most.
But in the biggest moment, it's the defense that makes the big play. David Wider with the sack, fumble, Raiders recover. It was Wider's first tackle in a Raider uniform. Wider, Dean, the unlikely heroes, they help SOU to a statement win, 38-35, the final.
The conference is set up so you have to play a home and an away with many of the conference teams. And so, you know, we're going to play them twice. And now this is the third time we're playing the number one ranked team in the country.
As soon as we knew we had Carroll, I know, like, in my mind, I was like, this is like a stage of manhood right now. It's about to be a battle. These guys are good. It's going to be tough.
When we'd gone there before, we got whooped pretty badly. And I don't know if there was memories of that game in the players' minds, or as we got into the game, it was back and forth. But they pretty much dominated the first half. In the second half, we caught fire. Dodge brought us back, and with 24 seconds left, we're going for 2 points to tie the game, and we failed. And playing Carroll at home is always tough. I mean, they don't lose at home.
Looked at it as a challenge, and we get to play Carroll College again and stuff like that.
Cut loose on these. Just cut loose. Just go have fun, man. Just cut loose on their ass. We know we can beat them. Let's go prove it.
They have a high breaking point. So do we. Don't blink. Have fun.
Simple thing. Offense, defense, have each other's back. Literally. If we don't get a score, Justin, get the ball back.
There's going to be adversity. There's going to be chaos. Fight through it. Battle through it. Overcome it. Stay positive.
Fight, scratch, all you gotta do, you know what I mean? Win, baby, just win.
When we found out we were playing Carroll, it was like Christmas.
We were excited.
Yeah.
You were to think, like, if you drew the number one team in the nation, you would think that there would be, like, people upset about it. I think for us, it was like, challenge time, let's go get it.
Waking up that morning, it was about 12 degrees. We entered the stadium, gained a feel for it. It was icy, it was snowy, it was cold.
First time we played Carroll, we showed them play after play that we could out physical. And in game two, they showed play after play that they were out physicaling us.
Defense when you have no footing and you're completely reactionary on defense.
Not be able to cap off drives and have to settle for field goals or turning the ball over on downs. That was a low point offensively.
Fourth and long here. Going to fire the ball incomplete. Roach dropped the back pressure. Going to fire that football to Griffin. He's open. He's got the ball.
Thank you.
I'm from Cali. It was a complete, total shock for me.
We would move the ball up and down the field, and then they would tighten down when the field got smaller and played really good red zone, low red zone defense.
Second quarter, Rinker's gonna run off left side, cut it back inside. There he goes, he's got some running room, and he may go. He's taking off from the 30-yard line. I don't know if he can catch him.
Let's go, big guy. Hey, go back, go back.
Looks like Carroll's gonna rush three and cover with eight. Dodge is gonna look to throw the football as his receivers run their routes and wide open down inside the five. Touchdown, Dustin Rinker.
You know, that Carroll College game was a Donnybrook. It was a great game, one of the classic games of all time, but we'll get to that later.
And yeah, coming from the Rogue Valley, the opinion of SCU wasn't very high. A lot of people didn't want to go to SCU, and it was like a... Could have been because it was so close to home, but a lot of people didn't even really know that they had the football program. It wasn't something people talked about.
A bunch of coaches from school started showing up, guys from Eastern, from all the D3 specific and all those schools, and everything they talked about, it just felt like I was at a used car dealership or something. They were just throwing numbers at me, and then Coach Stu walks in. We started talking about Ashland, talking about how they're bringing Coach Howard in.
And he's just recruiting the right guys that will buy into what he believes. And then once you get those first initial guys, and then everybody follows suit, and it becomes a big love and a family that we have.
And like Coach Howard would preach, like you're going to get a degree, you're going to be a better husband and a father to your kids and stuff like that. And it wasn't all based about football. And then that night, Coach Foss gave the offensive presentation. And he dismissed everybody to go with everybody else, but he made me stay back. And he humbled me. He really did humble me that day. And after I walked out of the room, I was like, Dad, I was like, I'm going to Southern Oregon.
It's, you know, when I have linebackers sit down and hear Coach Fisk has them in his office, these recruits feel like when they come here, you know, we might not have the facilities and some of the things that some of the bigger schools have, but what we do have is a staff that's going to care about them, and it's not just a line, it's not a punchline, it's not a sales job, it's something that means a lot to those families.
And Jackson, we'll give you a call this evening.
Absolutely. Well, hey, our head coach is sitting right here and wants to talk at you for a couple minutes, so here's Coach Howard.
Congratulations, Austin. We're delighted that you're going to become a Raider. I think it's going to be really special.
We went in and we changed the overall GPA in terms of the guys that we were looking for. Character line on the guys that we were looking for. We were talking to more people in schools, parents, teachers, coaches. Coach Howard always talks about talking to the librarian and the cafeteria lady. And
there's times you got in recruiting and coaches won't give you kids. At the end of the day, you know, we talk about it all we want to. We tell people we want to win a national championship. We tell them that's our intent. It's what we're going to do. It's our goal. And the reality of it was, you know, trying to get people to buy into that. Sometimes people would be perceptive to it, and sometimes they would say, you know what, I'm not going to give you the best kids that I have.
So when we got snickered at or scoffed at early in the recruiting process, we said, no, we're serious. And you could see the change over the 4 years, not over just this year. I mean, you know, the first year they said, God, they said you're going to be good on offense. Y'all are pretty good. And the next year, 11-2 and number one offense in the country. I said, you told everybody you're going to lead the country in offense. And then the next year you go, and God, your Austin Dodge guy's really good. And then the next year you come in there and you're recruiting players, and they said, you guys are pretty good.
Came in on the trip thinking that I was gonna go to SCU. It was like a courtesy thing. Like, I came and I sat down in the first meeting, and you know, you just hear Coach Howard start talking and saying stuff. And right away, I was like, well, damn, I gotta go there now. Like, I don't have a choice now.
Parents and kids will talk to us that I went to school X and Y, and these schools, we checked in and we did a little presentation, went out and partied with our hosts, and then we left the next day. And I think we've had an approach of bringing them in and showing them our character development side, our academic development side, and then we end it with football. We don't even talk football.
The things that we do today help win football games in the fall and in future falls to come.
This Shining Glass represents the hard work by a tremendous coaching staff and everybody here that contributed to signing these players. It's just not a football coach, it's a staff. It's an athletic director. It's a sports information director. It's our trainer. It's our support people. All the people that go into putting in a football program.
The thing that was different than all the other schools is that he preached the national championship. That was what we were going to do. And the other schools, they talked about, you know, about, oh, we're gonna, you know, build a program and do well. And, but he was so confident that we were gonna win and that we were gonna go to the national championship and we were gonna win it. And hearing him say anything, you could tell how much he loved what he was talking about and how much he loved football. And it really brought back my love for football from high school.
You know, run the spread offense, we needed to find a gunslinger. You've got to have a great quarterback, and we found one.
The key to that first recruiting class, a redshirt freshman transfer from Central Washington named Austin Dodge.
Career passing touchdowns, 154. Career passing yards, 17,263. Single season passing yards, 5,607. Passing yards per game in a season, 2012, was 423.1. Career total yards gained, 17,500. Dude, I don't know. When I was getting recruited out of high school, I had an okay junior year, and then I really hit a growth spurt my senior year. And you know, I had a season that I would have liked. I mean, that I expected out of myself, and I worked hard for that, and that kind of brought on the recruiters late. I didn't start getting recruited till a month before signing day. Took a visit to Central Washington. I felt like that was the right home for me and the right fit. It was close to home with a good program and the opportunity to be a big time player in that role. And for whatever the reasons may be, it just wasn't the right fit.
We saw this film of this young man playing quarterback, and all of us, our jaw fell on the floor. We went, wow, those throws are amazing. And Stu goes, this is the guy. We're going to win a national championship with this guy.
When I decided to transfer, a buddy of mine was going to be a starting receiver down at SOU and had just committed. And at that time, I'd never heard of Southern Oregon University. It's just, you know, it was just another college. And I met up with Coach Howard at Roscoe's Barbecue in Phoenix, Oregon. And the first thing he did was he came in, introduced himself, and he was with his daughter and grandson and started drawing up plays on napkins. And that's the first thing he did, and I was like, what is wrong with this old man? I mean, he's really crazy. Like, he's out of his mind.
We had some barbecue and got some barbecue sauce all over my face and shirt and drew up a lot of ball plays and, you know, napkins. And I said, come on down here and be our quarterback and help us win a national championship.
The quarterback position, I mean, you need to be a natural born leader at that position. It comes with the tag of being the quarterback. Head coach and the quarterback get all the fame and all the blame. And that's for a reason.
He went through some growing pains as a freshman when he got his first start, and even in the year we went to the quarterfinals, he had some leadership issues. He had so much confidence in his ability that he wasn't quite ready to take control of this football team.
I wasn't an outspoken leader. I wasn't that guy that was going to lead a team to a national championship. But at the same time, I wasn't expecting myself to be a leader that was going to lead a guy to a national championship at that time.
Those first 2 years just was a lot of growing up for him, I thought, and that was a lot of growing up for us receivers as well.
Thing is, with the players on this team, and me in particular, is there's a lot of learning you have to do if you want to be a leader. You have to take insight from a lot of these coaches who have had experience being a leader and being in a leadership role.
And we had a meeting right after the Eastern Oregon game, and you know, I was frustrated because we didn't win Eastern, you know, it's like anything else. And we talked, and he got frustrated because we didn't have the ball at the end of the game. And I said, you know, I failed you as a coach because I haven't taught you the leadership aspect. You've got most of it, but you need this other piece that you need these guys to play for you. And I said, if you want to win 4 games in a row, this has to become your team, but you got to make them love you.
He would demand perfection out of everybody that played on his offense, and he would let you know if you screwed up.
Being a leader, it's not easy. It really isn't. Sometimes being a leader requires getting on people, and And sometimes they don't like it, and sometimes you don't like being the guy that has to do it.
You know, I've never met such a competitor like himself, on and off the field. On the field during practice, his senior year, he became a true motivator for our offense and defense.
You think to yourself, well, this is my senior year. I want to go out with a bang, and I want to go out on top.
After we beat Carroll College, we still hadn't won the national championship. We've got to go to Chicago and play another team that had won the national championship previously in a great San Xavier program. But we were going in uncharted waters now. This is where, in 80 years of playing football, Southern Oregon had never been. You know, we'd never reached this level and gone this deep in the playoffs.
Think about what this game is. It's a big game. There can be a lot of pressure on it, but we need to go out there and not think about anything and just play the same way we have for the last 18 weeks. Just go out and have fun. If we have fun and go out and do what we're supposed to, we'll win the game.
Do it for your brothers. Do it for your family. Do it for your everybody.
Let's go, man.
That's all it is. Draw the line. Draw the goddamn line.
This is going to be the group that lets us play for two more weeks.
And this guy on the right and left of you, you play for that guy. You play your heart out. You play like there's no tomorrow, because God damn it, there is no tomorrow. Let's go, baby.
Again, you become a legend. History of Southern Oregon. You're going to take this school where they've never been before.
After the first touchdown, we knew that if it was going to be that easy all day, there was no way they were keeping up with us.
We were worried about all the zero pressures. I remember that on the offensive side. They bring all these blitzes, and I go, well, just throw deep, and that's what we do. Dodge goes, good, let them bring zero pressure. I can throw the ball deep.
Kiss the ball!
Yeah. Get her down there, find a way!
Let him run!
Find a way!
The guys had their minds made up, and that was another, you know, I don't want to say they were just a stepping stone, but, you know, the guys' vision was there.
Nothing was going to stop us. Nothing was going to stop the defense in the second half. Nothing was going to stop the offense in the second half.
It was so crazy the moment that you realize you're going. Why not you? He came in and said that to us the very first day, and I remember it like it was yesterday, because you don't think that way. A lot of people don't think that way. They pigeonhole themselves. And he walked in the room and he said, why not you? Why not the people in this room? Why can't you be the ones to do it?
Let's go get it, let's go get it.
You bought into that plan and you bought into that dream, and now we're going to Daytona.
We going to the ship.
I can go up to anyone in this program, give them a hug and say I love them. And that's just kind of this relationship that we've built over the year through everything that we've been through.
Telling my parents, ask me how it is, and then tell them it's great, like you have 100 new best friends.
The reason I play football, I don't play football for the touchdowns, for the highlights. I play football because I'm playing with my best friends. I'm playing with my family. That love on the teams really resounded through everybody. I mean, there's not a lot of fights on the team, and if it's fights, it's competitive fights because they're driving each other.
Look across the board, everybody on the team is just so much accountability, and you turn it around. I remember vividly in those playoff games at the end of the year, just looking around everybody, and I love every single man out here on this field.
Yeah. I think being around Coach Howard and the way we're trying to do things, one is you try to drive your life the way we're trying to teach the kids. Number two is find anything and everything about character development, things that can help them in their life, and I build what we call a winner's manual, and we try to use things out of that winner's manual throughout the year. I know personally for the offensive line in the off season, we're going to spend the first 10 to 15 minutes of a 45 position meeting on just character.
I think it starts with the coaching staff that helps build character, but I think being a part of a team with such great camaraderie and such great unity and such a tight, almost brotherhood, that you have guys on the team that you can trust, that you can go to, that want to help you, and that want to help you be a better person and a better athlete.
Hey, we all gotta play for each other, man, because it's the last time. Austin gonna be able to play, and it's the last time. Daniel, all the seniors, man, we gotta do it for everybody out here, man.
And just being around the guys so much, like seeing them every day of your life, actually really being around them, spending so much time together and interacting with each other, you learn the in and outs of everybody, I feel like, and that contributed to you not just playing for yourself out there, you're playing for the person next to you.
Cool guys, we don't like cool guys. So a cool guy is the guy who's not all in. A cool guy is the guy that's afraid to do what everyone else is doing on the team, afraid to conform to what the team is doing, the values of the team. You know, we have these things where, you know, when we do a warm-up at practice or something, the coach blows a whistle, everybody claps. The cool guy is the guy that doesn't clap. The cool guy is the guy that doesn't do what the team is doing. The cool guy is the guy that's out for himself, who's not buying in to what we're doing. And we did our best to make sure that we don't have any cool guys on our team. And any cool guys that were on our team didn't last very long.
Guys that maybe aren't as bought in or all for that, it's just like we're at a point in the season, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It's contagious, and you want to be a part of it because we're here now, and it's working.
And I'm gonna have to.
Having the time of our lives. It was our first experience down in Daytona, and you know, why not live it up? We will only get that opportunity one time, so why not have the best time of your life? I want you, I know you miss me. I hear the music and I feel to turn it up. The hours of the night like fire, we're burning up and I'm gone.
Jump into the ocean together tomorrow night, and we're coming here to win this football game.
soul from my face to my toes. Your love is my drug and I plan to overdose. Yeah, without a care I'm in my zone. The sun rising and we still going strong. I'm so gone, forever on. I'm glad I got.
There's nothing changed. There's no, oh, this is the national championship. We have to do this, we have to do that. No, there was none of that. Hope is gonna still work.
My remarks are going to be the players on both squads. You know, I want, remember the day you got a letter from Marion or from Southern Oregon University, a recruiting letter? You know, remember when you went on your dream visit? You remember fall camp and you sat in the dorm room and you looked at the ceiling and it was a hot day in Indianapolis or a hot day in Ashland and fall camp and you were away from home for the first time and you're thinking about quitting? Remember those summer workouts, remember those winter workouts, both teams. You paid a great price to get here. You were champions on and off the field. You didn't play in front of 100,000 people in a big stadium. You didn't play in front of CBS Sports or ESPN until now. You know, you played in small college stadiums across this nation. You made the playoffs. It might have been your senior year, it might have been your freshman year. You fought, you were behind at halftime, and you fought, you got that game won, you moved on to the next round. You got colder, you kept practicing, you kept playing, you kept winning. And in front of me is this trophy that you're going to play for tomorrow. But you are the epitome in this nation of what a student athlete is. You don't have a full ride. You're here because you love football and you love each other on both squads. And both teams work their guts out in those summer months. And that freshman year when you're staring at the wall, you didn't quit. You're still here, and I applaud you. All right, y'all give yourself a hand.
Last practice I'll ever have today, last game I'll ever play tomorrow, and just what a great way to go out. You know, those people that I love, all my best friends are on this team.
I just want you to know I'm going to give them my all for you. They're going to have to carry me off the stretcher by the end of this game.
I have never played with such a great group of guys, so I appreciate every single one of you guys.
It's going to be awesome tomorrow. You are going to be national champions.
Look at Austin Dodge, and he's the career leader in yards and touchdowns. It's not just that he has the new records, he crushed them. He has 3,500 yards more than the old NAIA record.
For Marion Tevin Lake, he is the main ingredient, the heartbeat of this offense. He's going to get those tough yards, and he has to be able to establish himself.
I know what to get on this bus after this. And talk about how close we came. I want to talk about how far we came. Let them get back on that plane and talk for the rest of their lives about how close they were. How close they were to being national champions.
And there's one thing missing. There's one thing missing. That last chapter. How are you going to make that last chapter? How are you going to finish that?
Come on.
What that is.
on the ground. Touchdown. Second effort, enough to get it in.
As it is, we're set to go. We have 30 more minutes of football to determine which one of these teams moves on and which one we'll call it a season after today. Big fourth down, fourth and goal from the 10. Play here for both teams. This could be a critical play. Dodge is looking to throw the football. Going to fire it down to the right side. Touchdown. It's under center. This time rolls to the right side, looking for Simak in the corner. He's open. He's got the ball. And touchdown, Carroll.
So dynamic in this game with multiple touchdowns. And through three quarters, he and his teammates have the upper hand here in this 59th NAIA National Championship.
Drop back, look to throw the ball down the field to Young. He's got to step on the defender. Touchdown, Raiders.
I think where the game really changed was on the third and short for them, middle of the third quarter, when when Lawrence Galcano took a run through and absolutely demolished, you know, their All-American running back.
When you see one guy do it, when you see one guy say, damn the cold. Calcano knocked that kid out, our sideline erupted. I mean, the defense was out there living it, but our sideline, I know our offensive linemen were jacked, our coaches were jacked.
So it's fourth down and five. Fourth and five from the 34-yard line. There's the snap. He'll look to the left side this time. Now back over the middle, fire the football. Complete. Complete to Matt Retzloff. So it's a big fourth down here. And to Mason straight ahead, and he's got the first down and more touchdowns. Southern Oregon. Snap. Puts all kinds of pressure. Rhodes will stay in the pocket and he's going down. They've got him and down he goes. They're down by two with 5 minutes or so to go. They're going to throw it downfield and try to get it all back right now. Touchdown! Southern Oregon's to hold on to as they lead it 39-35. 2:03 on the clock. Rhodes with the snap. He's going to throw the ball to Clark and there's a penalty flag. And at the 10-yard line, takes the snap and he's going to run it himself. Straight ahead. He's close. Did he get in? Touchdown, Carroll. Touchdown, Carroll, and the clock reads 1:53.
We'll be right back.
drops straight back, looks to throw it down the field, and he finds a wide open receiver running free, got loose from Wymore. It's number 11, he's still running.
You know, the national championship game was played in Daytona, Florida, right next to a beach and a sunny Florida weather. But we won it when we beat Carroll in the snow in Helena.
Dodge moves Mason to the left side, fires it out to Matt Retzloff, one man to beat, and he gets around him. He's down inside the 5-yard line, down to the 1-yard line.
All line to Melvin, this is all you, all the
times getting rid of bad. They love it when you're down, you're happy they get mad. I ain't tripping about the darkness, just waiting for the sun and seeing all the stars, exactly what we become. Can you feel it? In a minute we'll be living right there with cribs on the screen, yeah, on me right there. Women keep on pressing, but I bench them like a player. I'm busy right now, girl, I'll tend to you later. And OG said it won't happen overnight, but overnight you'll understand the truth was really right and realize the game you're playing with your life. And either you're a quitter or you're standing up to fight. Ignorance is bliss, you know it all hurts, but I gotta know the truth if I'm trying to make it work. So as time passes by, I'm lighting me up some perk and rise above evil wherever that can lurk. I'm just waiting on some change. I'm just waiting on some change. Yeah, I'm just waiting on some change. I've been waiting on some change. Feel it, yo. Give me more cheese, bout to pop, I want some more, please. Say my it's dope, we toast to getting morphines. With a morphine, let it pump into your soul. Bass hit your body and we out of control. Puffing loud packs, blowing switches in the wind. Not a lot of people with me, just my closest friends. On the road doing shows, now who start to notice him? What they looking for, huh? What they hoping to find? I'm just scoping the dime. I've got dreams for the top, selling dope for the grind. If it's money, I'ma make it, take it, girl, if she fine. Got sand in my hand, people swear it's my time. Yeah, I'm just waiting on progression. Standing in a line that I swear I'm about next in. It's a lesson, learn from the rest and continue to always give out more than your best, man. Yeah, I'm just waiting on some change. Yeah, I'm just waiting on some change. I'm just waiting on some change. Yeah, we've been waiting on some change. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Working hard. No bull. Just trying to make this my life.